try to show an ad later, but we'll see how that works out. I have students in the room, they will tell up to you about my low. I want to echo Jeff's comments first of all and say this is a privilege to be on this panel with these folks. Jeff and I do some administrative work, so it's scary to hear about that report card. Those of us in, and some of you I'm sure in the room do that as well. That got brought up, we just tried to not worry about that after they said it was going to happen. And so far that strategy has worked out for us. we'll see that next. But anyway, I'm here to talk to you today, if you can see the program, about a concept called managerial rhetoric that Michael Spruill developed in the late 80s. And I applied that to some advertisements from the Hillary Clinton campaign in 2008. The ads were actually released, not surprisingly, in 2007. And you can probably figure out that my hopes were that I would be able to do a nice comparison, since we have this unique situation going on, having a Trump owner appear two times in two different cycles. They don't actually release the ads quite as early as I would have expected. Within 2 weeks after our deadline for the conference that I finally saw for the Clinton ad. So that's how that worked out, but that's something to do in the future, or some of you that are interested in political advertising might want to take that on. Spruill's concept of managerial rhetoric really has to do with his concern about a shift from old rhetoric even in the 19th century to what he called new managerial rhetoric of the 20th century, rooted in ideas that rhetoric had come to enhance conclusions over reasons and image over ideas. My ideas and ideas and ideas. He also proposed, though more specifically, seven dimensions of this managerial rhetoric. And so what I did was examine, close examination of the 10 Hillary Clinton ads from 2007, seven times using seven different dimensions. And so I'll try to hit the high points a little bit about what I found in terms of whether Spruill really had much explanatory power of what Clinton was doing in 2007, whether his ideas were really manifesting themselves in the 21st century. After you look at these ads seven times, you also can take these dimensions and kind of group them. So we first talk about a grouping of Spruill's dimensions, and they are one that, again, rhetors now tend to use conclusions rather than reasons. They tend to use self-contained slogans rather than emblematic reasoning, minor for major, minor conclusion premise type format. And that they create facts rather than utilize facts that they found somewhere else. Okay, so those three dimensions are kind of putting together. First, in terms of making claims, conclusions, without directly providing reasons for those conclusions, there were some examples of that in the 10 Clinton ads that I had access to. And by the way, I'm going to refer to these ads, I know, using a title. I did not have the slates or that information on the ad, so the titles are my titles that I gave them, just fairly descriptive names for what they cover. In an ad called "One Candidate," Clinton struggled with constituents. The narrator claims that she'll do certain things, that she's ready to leave, but frankly, there's absolutely no information provided as to why. Okay. But what's probably more interesting is kind of the theme that runs through the ad. In some other ads like energy jobs and social security, there very much is evidence provided. In energy jobs, she's talking about creating jobs, and she's going to do that by creating a strategic energy fund, and also going to pay for that by eliminating tax subsidies on oil companies. Now, it's a 30-second ad, so I'm not saying it's a complicated argument, but it's an argument. Okay? It's not just a claim. She has provided some evidence in social security, which is the one that I hope to show. It's a very emotionally evocative ad, but it's undergirded with claims that she has fought the privatization of Social Security throughout her career, references a particular law she helped create while a senator, and also that she fights against long-term insurance scams. So some very clear, at least claims, about what she's done, along with, frankly, some emotion. In terms of self-contained slogans, she didn't really use that many. What I found interesting from the ads I was able to get at, she used things like, if we are ready for change, she is ready to lead. If you're ready for change, she's ready to lead. So I didn't really find find much evidence necessarily what Sproul was talking about, but hindsight, if not being 2020, at least a little better than foresight, you can't help but pick up on that word change and then think about how that election went with the current president who used the phrase hope and change, and Hillary may still be upset about that one, but anyway, President Obama used it much more effective than using that word. And where one of the more interesting things I found, again, using Sproul as my starting point, was while I wouldn't go so far as to say Clinton used anything like a formal intermeme in an ad, she did use rhetorical questions and put things together. The scripts were put together in a very clever way to lead people to a conclusion. So again, it's not enigmatic, but it is an interesting strategy. In an ad that I called Universal Healthcare, for example, Clinton supported the concept when almost no one else would. And also, so now that almost every candidate is standing up for healthcare for all, which one do you think will never back down? So that's an example of obviously leading us to the conclusion that at the time of the primary, out of all the candidates, she is the legitimate voice on universal health. Everybody else is just coming to this after the fact. Again, in Social Security, there's a quote from the script. These days, it seems like every candidate on earth is coming here for you, but which candidate has been there for you all along? I really like that phrase, every candidate on earth. Mm-hmm. Because what that's doing in four words, it's dismissing the entire other field as illegitimate on the issue of Social Security. And again, that ad had some other claims that could at least be, she didn't necessarily provide all the evidence, but you could go out and verify with what she was saying in the episode. In terms of creation of facts, and I didn't think about it like this until this paper because of using Sproul's framework, obviously many, if not most, facts that we see in devices like political advertisements are at some level created. They are not just found, they're built, they're part of obviously an overall rhetorical strategy. One thing that really struck me is in these Clinton ads, I got quotes like this: we will end this war, we will give health coverage to everyone, we will be energy independent. Those are really not facts, but they're proposed as things that are almost, well, they're proposed as things that certainly will become facts if you vote a certain way. Now, on this point, I want to make clear, you're going to see this from every candidate, and that's kind of an overall thing I can tell you. I went to the University of Oklahoma and studied political communication, and many of you know they have the archive over there. I've watched thousands of these ads, so I do want to, this is a general disclaimer. The things I'm seeing in these ads are very similar to the things you see these types of things. Image over ideas and interpersonal attraction and identification, those are two other schools I mentioned, and I explained those two. Again, the main point here is in these ads, Clinton engages in a great deal of invisibility. She's using the techniques of 2007, production techniques, soft music in ads that are also talking about children, issues related to children, close-ups of a father telling the story about how Clinton helped them get a needed operation for their son, that type of thing. And all of those always are linked to some information. Even that one about the teenage boy who was sick talked about that she got them the operation that they needed, actually, to trust her. So there's image, but it's not necessarily replacing ideas. It's in concert. In terms of interpersonal attraction and identification, and this is a technique that not all candidates use, Clinton is definitely the star of these ads. She is front and center. Some candidates, for various reasons, aren't actually in their ads as much. For various reasons. But Clinton was the star of her ad. And it's kind of a dual purpose, seemed to be what they were after in these ads. She is shown in both intimate settings, so very interpersonal. One ad is great. In one ad, she was a farmer, a child, a baby factory worker working in a pizza restaurant and a veteran holding a child. Very impressive in 30 seconds. Interpersonal. But even in that ad, at the end, she's in front of a crowd and a standard set up in very much a position in power. And you see that throughout the ad. Stressed interpersonal and powerful. And I got a few students from my propaganda class, and I know I'm almost out of time here. We've seen that in one of the first ones we were able to watch in class. Okay. Same sort. I think those are the main points. There's a couple of other schools mentioned, but I didn't find much with those, so we'll skip those since I'm out of time. That'll be fine. The takeaway that I have from this, really, is that there was Spruill's framework was somewhat useful in explaining some of that. But the reality is, her ads, and I'm sure many 21st century politicians' ads, they're going to really have a higher level of sophistication than what Spruill's talking about. They are certainly going to use image. They're going to make some claims that they don't back up. But they're also always tied, in the Clinton case, they're tied to issues. There is some evidence presented. And so there are things that you can just check on. She is not just trying to tell the story and expecting anyone to believe it. And really, if you watch most politicians, certainly on a national level, that's going to be the case. And as I said, some of you may be watching some of her ads now, so you'll be able to do some comparisons. I'll give this one shot. You have 10 minutes for questions.